Flash memory is a type of non-volatile storage technology. It's a memory retaining data even when the power supply is disconnected. We have already seen EEPROM in a previous video. That's another type of memory retaining data. And like EEPROM, flash memory can be erased and reprogrammed. And basically, EEPROM and flash share the same core technology. But there are main differences between the two types of memory. EEPROM allows a byte level of writing, and it can overwrite any information previously stored. Flash needs two separate steps, a memory erase involving a large block of memory, and a writing again involving a memory area. Actually, there are two types of flash memory, NOR flash memory and NAND, each one with distinctive characteristics. NOR flash allows a fast random access to the memory, while NAND allows a higher density and a lower cost. This table compares datasheet of some memory chip. AT24C256 is an I2C 32 KB EEPROM. I already shown it in a video about EEPROMs and how to develop fast handling functions, avoiding program hanging after writing. W25Q64 is an 8 MB SPI NOR flash, and it is one of the memories we will see in details next in this video. W25 and 512 is a 64 MB NAND flash made by Winbond, the same manufacturer of the NOR memories we will analyze. You see, I said that EEPROM allows a writing at byte level, but EEPROM also is organizing pages. A writing command sent to the memory can involve just one page. That means that no more than 64 bytes can be written in an EEPROM in a single command. And any time we send a writing command to an EEPROM or a flash, we must worry about not overwriting the page boundary. You see that NOR and NAND technology need absolutely different times on the erasing command. And you see also that EEPROM needs a long time in the writing cycle. Read cycle time is meaningless over these memories, as the time requested by I2C or SPI in transferring data to the microcontroller is relevant. To analyze the reading cycle, we must refer to the datasheet of our products. These are the timing of a reading cycle of three parallel chips, again an EEPROM, a NOR flash and NAND flash. You see that a random read needs 200 nanoseconds on EEPROM, and a NOR flash needs a quite shorter time. NAND memory has two separate timings, a random access reading time and a sequential one. You see that a random access read needs an extremely longer time compared to the other type of memories. But after accessing the first byte, the next sequential reading are quite faster. Differences in performance make EEPROM, NOR flash and NAND flash useful in different working areas. EEPROM is used storing parameters, or anyway a small amount of data that needs to be rewritten in a project lifetime. NOR flash is normally used to store the program code, as the fast random access allows to run it directly reading from flash. And NAND flash is normally used for larger storage needs. These are three sizes of a W25Q SPI NOR flash memory by Winbond. I will use these chips testing the library I'll show you here, together with the external loader I will show you how to develop for your projects. W25Q80 is a 1 MB chip. That's the chip available on the WeAct Black Pill board, and you know I'm used to use this board in my prototypes. W25Q64 is an 8 MB chip I have on my breakout board. There is a lot of this kind of breakout boards, but even using the same chip, they are not all the same. I will show you which ones, in my opinion, are the best to buy for your prototypes. W25Q128 is a 16 MB chip available in the JLC PCB Basic Part catalog. If you have seen my previous video, you know that I'm used to make my boards using the GLC PCB services. And it is useful, the opportunity to have a flash chip in the basic part list. Memory is able to communicate in the standard SPI with the classic MISO and MOSI pins, the clock pin and the chip select active low. Chip allows also a dual SPI, where MISO and MOSI become bidirectional data pins, doubling the port speed. It can handle also a quad SPI speed connection, using two more pins for data transfer. Despite the differences in size, all the three chips we see have the same internal organization, having a page size of 256 bytes, sectors of 4 kilobytes, and blocks of 32 or 64 kilobytes. We have seen that pages are used in writing operations, while sectors and blocks are involved in erasing the memory areas. There is one more erasing command, the full chip erase. In order to avoid unwanted memory erasing and writing, a multi-level protection is available on chip. There is a write protect pin available controlling writings. Then, before sending a write command, memory requires a separated write enable command. A third protection level is available setting protection bits at sector level or following other schemes, allowing areas of the chip write protected while other areas are allowed to be rewritten. In the library, I handle only the write enable command, working this way. Chip has a status register that we can poll knowing the chip status. Here we have two bits, write enable latch and the busy bit. Both are normally low. In this status, memory can be read, but no writing or erasing command are accepted. Sending to the chip the write-enable command, write-enable latch bit will rise, and the memory will accept writing commands. After receiving a writing or erasing command, the memory starts a write cycle, raising the busy bit. While the memory is in this status, it will discard any reading or writing command received, but will reply to a status register reading command. So we can poll it, verifying if the write cycle completes. When the write cycle ends, both bits return to zero, so we need to send a new write enable command before writing. So, this is the configuration I'm using in the library, communicating with external flash. The reason for that is that I set this library to handle external flash even with the low-featured STM32s, without the availability of a quad SPI. And with a simple SPI communication, we will see in the next video about TouchFX that this configuration gives the faster results. This is the library I developed for the Winbond W25Q memories. It covers all the main functions of these devices. An init function performs a chip reset verifying that an SPI is connected a working flash memory from Winbond. It is possible to go over verifying the connected device is the expected memory type and expected size. I haven't implemented this control, but I added in the function description information to perform these controls in case of needs. More information in the documentation available by Winbond and JEDEC through the links in the video description. Library provides functions for the various memory area erasing commands. The sector erase 4K, block erase 32K, block erase 64K, and chip erase. Let's see how these erasing functions work, taking a look to the chip erase. It starts enabling chip select, then a write enable command sending, and the chip select disable, ending the command sequence. Next, a new chip select, the chip erase command sending, and a new chip select disable. Now the internal chip erasing starts. Function, wait for the erase completing, looping on the reading the status register, until the busy bit resets. Writing command follow the same logic. Splitting data to write in memory pages to be written separately. Reading is not limited by the page size. Some library parameters need to be set before the usage. They are located on top of a .h file. Here you have to define the SPI port used for the flash memory, the SPI mode and the SPI communication mode. Leave SPI mode and SPI communication unchanged. Finally, the device parameters, memory size and other information. Configuration is easy, and I leave in the comments configuration for the memories we see here. W25Q80, W25Q64 and W25Q128. Using this library, you have a full control of the flash memory. Let us see how to use the memory and the library in a project. I will use a React backfill with a W25Q80 on the board. Let's create a new project. Choosing NF411, click Next. Give a name to the project and click Finish. Now, for this test, I leave enable the HSI and set it to 100 MHz. In System Core, Sys Debug, I enable the Share Wire Debug. That's to program and debug the microcontroller. Now, as per React board schematics, flash memory is connected to PA5, 6 and 7, having chip select on PA4. PA5, 6 and 7 are the pins for SPI1. So, I enable SPI1 in full duplex, 8-bit, and I leave it at 50 MHz. Set pin names. Speed, initial level, that should be high for chip select. Generate C files. Add library. And modify main.h, adding the library include. Go to the library.h file and save the configuration. Following steps 1 to 4. Flash is on SPI1. Step 2 and 3 unchanged. All parameters on step 4 must be set. For some memory chip, including the W25Q80, I register configuration in the comments. So I delete the current configuration and copy the configuration for this chip. Now I can set up some tests in main.c. As first step I call flash init, which will return 1 if a Winbond flash chip was found. Then I test a chip arrays. Now I set up a test string. I write it into the memory. And clear the string. Now I read it back to see if I correctly get data from flash. Ok, compile program. And run it in the bug. Setting a breakpoint to flash init, I run the program. Now I go on step by step. Flash init is OK. Chip arrays needs a long time. As per datasheet, it can require up to 20 seconds. Here I monitor the string. I write it, clear it, and reading back from flash, I see it's working. Good. External loader is a sort of plugin for STM32CubeProgrammer allowing to read and write serial flash memory chip through the microcontroller handling it. The external loader allows CubeProgrammer to use the serial memories as they are mapped on the microcontroller address range. Assigning a starting address to the serial flash and knowing its size, any time CubeProgrammer tries to reach the flash, it will call the external loader, which will handle the communication to the flash memory. The same external loader can be also used in CubeID. As actually, CubeID calls CubeProgrammer modules to program the microcontroller flash. We will see now how to set up an external loader for a project using an SPI flash. I said we have to set up an external loader for a specific project because as we are working with flash memories communicating via standard SPI, we know that we have many SPI ports available on the microcontroller, and usually any SPI port can be connected to many different microcontroller GPIO pins. Moreover, we could use any GPIO as a chip select pin. So, we cannot define a unique external loader for a microcontroller, or a combination of a microcontroller and flash chip. We have to be able to set up a specific external loader for the specific microcontroller configuration and the memory chip used in our project. Here I will show you how to set up it using my library for the Winbond SPI flash memories I've shown you right now. I will use my GitHub page as a guideline for the setup. I will leave a link to it in the video description. So let's start setting up a couple of examples. We have already seen that a black pill provided with a serial flash has it connected to SPI1 on the pin PA5, 6 and 7 using PA4 for chip select. Microcontroller in my case is NM411. Let me show you also that we have a user LED on PC13. It is connected to 3.3, so it is on when pin level is low. While I was developing external loader functions, I used the LEDs on the board to troubleshoot and debug. I left the user LED handling in the library functions. If you have a LED available on your board, as here now, you can use it. It could be useful for troubleshooting. Ok, to set up an external loader for your board, create a new project on CubeIDE. As we said, microcontroller is an F411. Next. Give a project a name with this format. The first part of the name refers to the memory chip. Then underscore. Then a reference to the board or the microcontroller you are using. Here it could be, for instance, STM32F411. I will use blackpill-F411. Do not use underscore inside the names. It must be used only dividing the first part by the second one. Now you can, but it is an option, add a second underscore and the final information. I will add underscore LED, indicating that the external loader will use the board user LED. Click Finish. Now I'm setting up a very simple configuration. For instance, board has an high-speed external clock available, but I leave a HSI. I will set the clock to 100 MHz. Now I set up the SPI1. All parameters as requested by the flash memory library. And the same for the pin names. Now I set PA4 and PC13 as GPIO output. PA4 will be the flash chip select. Again, pin name and parameter as requested by the library. And I will call PC13 simply LED. That's the name requested. Initially high, so it will be off on startup. Now go to Program Manager, Code Generation, and select the Generate Peripheral Initialization as a pair of .c and .h files per peripheral. Generate the code. Now, following the GitHub page about the external loader setup, copy from the same GitHub page the .h files into the include folder. Copy the .c files into the source folder. In the project root folder, copy the el_linker.ld file and the postbuildcommand.txt file. Now open the flash.h file. And set the configuration parameters, step 1 and step 4. Leave unchanged the other ones. Here, I copy the available set of parameters I registered for the chip used in the Blackpill board. If you are using a different chip, the information required by the library are easily available from the corresponding memory datasheet. Now open the loader_rc file. Here also we have to set up some parameters. That's what refers to the user LED. As I have a LED available on the board and I set it on CubeMX, here I enable the LED usage and commenting the blinking information. On step 2, I have to register the pin level corresponding to an on LED. Finally, on step 3, I have to set the name of a function initializing the SPI port. This function has normally the form mx_spi123andso_init, depending to the SPI port used for the flash. Anyway, you can verify the function name to use here, looking into the spi.c file. Here there is the init function to call, and that function name has to be set into the loc_spi_init function. Next step is related to the dev_inf.c file. This file is from the external loader examples I got by the ST websites. Into the struct we see on the top, we have to correctly set the external loader file name. The first field registers the address where the flash chip has to be mapped on the microcontroller address range. Address hex 97x0 is a good address to map flash, and it is what ST suggests to use. If you don't have specific needs, use this address. Anyway, as I said, here is a point to register the address where the SPI memory chip is mapped. Now open the postbuildcommand.txt file. And copy the content. Go to Project, Properties, C++ Build, Settings, Build Steps, and paste into the field command in postbuild steps. Apply and close. In the el_linker file, we have to correctly set the microcontroller RAM size. Open the file and into the RAM length field, indicate the microcontroller RAM size. I leave 128K. Finally, in Project, Properties, C++ Build, Settings, Tool Settings, MCU GCC Linker, General, Tool Settings, change the name of the linker script to use. It has to be el_linker.ld. Uncheck the field Discard Unused Section. That's what I normally forget to do. Obtaining a non-working external loader. Apply and close. Now I just need to compile the project and I get the .stldr file, which is the external loader. You can note that I get a warning. It refers to the dev_inf.c file. I told you that this file comes from the ST examples. I left it unchanged. Now I can copy the external loader I made into CubeProgrammer and test it. I have to detect the folder where CubeProgrammer is installed. To find it, you can, for instance, left-click the CubeProgrammer icon and follow the open file location. Here is the bin folder where CubeProgrammer is installed. Here there is a subfolder called External Loader. It contains a huge list of external loaders for all the ST evaluation boards. It is a really big list, and opening CubeProgrammer selecting the external loader, you can get the same huge list. As I will never use all of those loaders, I clean the folder. I create an archive subfolder and move into it all the examples from ST. Now, I move into the clean folder my external loader. This way, opening CubeProgrammer, and selecting external loader, I will see a list with only the external loader I'm interested to. In this case, the only one I made. You can see that CubeProgrammer detects from the struct we set the program name, the board we refer, and other information. Note the starting address we set. I select the external loader and connect the board through ST-Link and going to read the address where the flash is mapped, I get the flash content. It works. Information and examples to understand an external loader are spread over various ST information sources. CubeProgrammer user manual explains what is an external loader and its use. The same CubeProgrammer package contains source files of examples understanding how external loader works. There is also an ST GitHub repository showing other examples. And there is an STM mock about developing external loaders. In the video description, I will leave a link to all of this information. I took the examples in the CubeProgrammer package and in the GitHub repository, and I adjusted them adapting to the Flash library I developed. Let's take a look to the external loader we made right now. External loader is a set of functions the CubeProgrammer will call accessing to the flash memory. Functions are in the loader underscore src.c file. There is an init function, which performs the GPIO and SPI initialization, then runs the flash initialization, calling the library function. A read function has a buffer address to store the data from flash. You see that in any functions I left the original function description I got from my examples. You see also that in each function I call a letOn function at the beginning and a letOff at the end. The write function has the same format as the read function. This is a full ship arrays and a sector arrays function. Now there is a checksum function. It calculates a checksum of a flash interval indicated in parameters. I left it unchanged as the algorithm used is quite cryptic to me. And reading the function description I told you I left unchanged, it seems that I am not the only one that hardly understands this algorithm. Last function is a verify one. It reads a flash area and compares it to the RAM content. Let's make a new example of an external loader using this time a flash over a breakout board I got from AliExpress. This is a W25Q64, an 8 megabit SPI flash. On AliExpress, Amazon or other website, you can find many of these breakout boards for your prototypes. And you can see that, quite often, this board makes available only 6 pins. This way you will have available only D0 and D1 data pin of a flash, allowing you only a standard SPI communication. It's better to select breakout boards like this one, providing a connection to all the flash pins, allowing me, when I will need it, a quad SPI connection to the breakout board. And I will show you in the next video a library based on quad SPI, allowing a quite faster library, external loaders and projects, using microcontrollers able to perform this communication. So, the board I will use in this second test is this one. I'm using a Nucleo 32 L432KC and a W25Q64. L432 has available also a quad SPI port that I will not use here. Memory is connected to SPI1. And being unused with this library, IO2 must be connected to the ground, IO3 to VDD. Let's create a new project on CubeID. I select the microcontroller I'm using, in this case an L432KCU3. Next. Again, assign a standard name, indicating the flash used, underscore, a reference to the board, underscore, and other information. I will add indication to the LED and the chip select pin I'm using. On CubeMX, I set HSI at 80 MHz. Here I have to be careful setting the SPI data size to 8-bit. And working on prototypes with flying wiring and a breakout board, I don't push SPI port to very high speeds. Normally I set it below 2 megabit per second. Assign pin names. Now, referring to the board schematics you can get on the ST webpage, we can see that user LED, is connected to PB3, and it is active high, being the LED connected to the ground. So on CubeMX, I activate PB3, initially low, give the name LED. In Project Manager Code Generation, I set the flag I already shown you. Generate C files. Now I repeat the setup steps I followed in the first example. Referring to my GitHub page, copy.h and .c files, copy the file for the root directory, set parameters inside the flash.h file, indicating the data referring to the W25Q64. Set parameters in loaders src.c. Here I set that the LED is on when the pin is high. And I verify to use the correct SPI init function. In devinf.c, I put the project name. The rest is unchanged. I set the postbuild command. I set the correct memory size in the linker configuration file. L432 has 64 kilobytes. And set a CubeID to use the new linker configuration file. Don't forget to unmark this pin. Compile, getting the .stldr file. And a warning in the devinf.c. Now we move the external loader into the CubeProgrammer folder. And when I start CubeProgrammer, I find it in the external loader list. Enable it. Connect the board. I prepared a .bin file to load into the flash, to test it, and testing also the external loader. A .bin file is a simple sequence of bytes that will be written into the flash. Here you see I prepare a sequence of 256 bytes, ending with a CRLF, just for an easier file handling with the editor. I go into Erasing and Programming and start the file loading. On the board, I can see the LED indicating the memory erasing, the pages programming. Reading the flash content, I can see the data written into it. If I enable the verify memory content after programming, I will see the flash erasing, programming, and verifying. Okay, that's all. We have seen how works a library prepared handling the W25Q flash memories from Winbond and how to use it. We have seen also how to set up a project in CubeIDE generating an external loader program. And we have seen also how to use the external loader we made in CubeProgrammer to program, verify and reading the content of the flash memory. In the next video, we will see how to use the external loader in a CubeIDE project and in a TouchGFX project. In both cases, external loader allows an easy flash handling, storing into it large information that just need to be read on runtime. That's the case, for instance, of images, overriding the limit of internal flash sites, allowing us to use them in a project using displays in both cases. Directly handling the display or using the TouchGFX package. See you to the next video.